India, we researched on, we studied two issues, the anti-rape movement in India and the domestic workers' rights movement in India. This presentation is only on the anti-rape movement in India. Many of us will, if we know about India, many of us will recall the outrage and the shock that we felt when a 23-year-old woman, a paramedic student, was raped in a bus by six men, one of them being a juvenile, and which led to a firestorm of public discourse in India and I think internationally as well. That incident actually pushed the government to make important legal changes to the rape laws in the country. So I'll be taking that as one moment, as one of the recent moments in India. And over 35 years back, similarly, a Supreme Court judgment with respect to the Mathura rape case also led to a public an outrage and a public discourse in India, which actually became the watershed moment for the anti-rape movement in India. So we look at these two moments, Mathura and Nirbhaya, referring to the recent rape of the 23-year-old woman in December 2012. She was christened as Nirbhaya, as the fearless woman. This is not to say that in between there were no important or significant mobilizations, but we're just looking at these two moments to understand the broad contour of relationship between women's mobilization and the state. So the first part of the presentation will be briefly of what has been the relationship of women's groups and the state. And the second part of the presentation is basically focusing on two issues. There are many issues in the mobilizations, but of course in the 15 minutes presentation we cannot focus on that. So we're just looking at two. One is how women have been trying to understand the concept of rape legally, and secondly, concept of gender neutrality. So we will come to that. So in 1978, when it all started, the Supreme Court of India actually reversed a High Court judgment which had convicted two policemen for raping a minor tribal girl in their custody. And on the appalling grounds that she was habituated to sex, because she was in a relationship with a boy, so she was seen as habituated to sex, and she and there was absence of injuries, so she had consented. So that was the judgment, and the two policemen were acquitted. This led to a major outrage among the women's mobilization, and began with the open letter by four professors who questioned the conscience of the judgment and the rightness of the judgment. This, again, it was a catalyst to women's mobilization. The government responded to the mobilization, and the Law Commission was set up, which again took 2 to 3 years in reviewing the laws, and then eventually there was, in 1983, the Criminal Law Amendment Act. So since the Indian emergency was very alive and fresh at that time, women had been asking to shift the burden of proof onto the accused rather than the prosecution, especially under custodial cases, and which actually was heard by the amendment, and a new category called custodial rapes was introduced. This was to mean that police officers or those in a custodial relationship will have higher punishment. So it was the first time that a 10-year punishment was also instituted. Also, keeping in mind the Mathura rape case and a few other cases like Ramiza B and Maya Tyagi, where past sexual history was used as evidence in rape trials. So the demand was that the past sexual history should not be included as evidence, but that was not accepted in the 1983 amendments. At that time, women were in a way happy that rape entered the public discourse, which was a taboo subject earlier. But there was also a little bit of skepticism with the law reform, because as it panned out, women groups realized that the procedures, investigations, the judiciary were actually falling back to the same norms and in understanding how a victim has to be characterized. So they realized that much more has to be done in terms of legal reforms or social reforms. In 1990s, the NCWs, the National Commission for Women, set up a subcommittee and included women's groups and child rights groups to understand the concept of rape, and to remove the stigma associated with rape in India. Again, there was another case of incest that had happened, in which a child was raped, but it was taken as outraging modesty or outraging the modesty, and not as rape. So an organization had requested, a writ petition was submitted to asking for direction in understanding rape in such circumstances. So again, a law commission was set up, and then there were series of bills that happened, especially around the NCW suggestions on, they had actually introduced sexual assault as a term and not as rape, and a graded set of sexual assaults. The Law Commission had come up with another bill based on the NCW recommendations. Lots of women groups were starting to meet together, consulting each other, and then they were coming up with the bills. This was a time of many bills, and the government was also instituting bills after bills. So they reverted to some concepts of rape, sometimes sexual assault, sometimes gender neutrality. So it was a mixed picture. Then Nirbhaya happened in December 2012, and as you know, there were mass agitations, and there were basically young people and across the country, and feminist voices were very important in this period, when they were actually trying to shape the public discourse through media, especially through social media. And again, the government was very quick in instituting the Justice Verma Committee, and for the first time it was very inclusive in its process. It invited recommendations from a wide variety of actors, and we had 80,000 submissions that came in through various groups, especially women's groups. The JVC recommendations, again, widened the definition. It did not include sexual assault. It said rape has to be included, because the humiliation associated with rape has to be there, but it looked at a nuanced understanding of gender neutrality to say there should be a gender specificity for the perpetrator. The perpetrator could only be a man, and gender neutrality for the victim, so that it could be a woman, a transgender, a sexual minority, anybody could be the victim, to basically include wide experiences of rape and sexual assault. They also recommended criminalization of marital rape, which is still not recognized in the Indian legal system. Again, the archaic notion of outraging the modesty of a woman had to be removed, and a new set of sexual offences. So there were wide-ranging recommendations, and the women groups were very happy with how the JVC engaged with them and the recommendations that came out of it. And this is a quote that one of the interviewee had said, as JVC as a watershed moment, but how when we see the Criminal Amendment Act that followed, did accept some of the recommendations, but actually left out a few, which she says the citadels of impunity remained intact. So the Criminal Law Amendment Act that followed widened the definition of rape. It did not include sexual assault as a term, but widened the definition of rape to include all kinds of penetrations, not just vaginal penetration. So any object or any part of the body used for penetration would also be included as rape. It retained gender specificity, so there was no mention of gender neutrality across board. The ordinance before that had gender neutrality across board, and everyone was concerned what would happen. And there were they included lots of other offences like acid attacks, stalking. Again, outraging of the modesty of women was retained, and marital rape was again not accepted. They did not decrease the basically they increased the age to 18. So a person raped under 18 would be considered. I mean, a person under 18 is considered as someone who cannot consent to sex. So that was it was initially 16, but now it's 18. And they did not repeal AFSPA, which is an act to say that army personnel could not be prosecuted in civil courts. We come to the second part of the presentation. We just look at two issues. One is how, this is basically to understand what is the content of the oppositional discourses, the women's discourses. What is the content? At one, we're taking one issue where there is consensus and another issue where there is fragile consensus. So one is the recategorization of the offense of rape. We know that in India, I'm sure in other countries as well, there are lots of social norms and prejudices that are associated with victims of rape. So there is a typical pattern of how a state interprets or characterizes a woman or, who is victim of rape, which has proved since the beginning a very difficult challenge for the feminists. So one is the understanding of rape being seen as heterosexual rape, and then you see the discourse of shame, stigma, defilement. Often we have legislators talking about victims of rape as zinda lash, meaning a living corpse. It's like as good as being dead. So these are the kind of the dominant discourse about rape. The feminist claims is basically to intervene by speaking the language of right, of survival, and you know, rather than victimhood. So a bodily integrity, and to challenge the typical pattern of understanding rape. As I mentioned, there was NCW, which introduced the term sexual assault instead of rape, and they looked at three forms. They had a gradation. Sexual assault was to replace the earlier modesty, the outraging the modesty of women. Penetrative sexual assault was to have all kinds of penetrative sexual assaults, not just penile, but also objects and parts of the body. Aggravated sexual assault was to include the grievous bodily harm sexual assaults. Again, this has led to various consultations among women, but there is a sense of consensus that we need to replace this term rape with sexual assault. But how this term has to be replaced is, a discussion does take place on that. What happened with this discussion, what happened is the Criminal Law Amendment Act did widen the definition. It widened the definition from penovaginal penetration to include all kinds of penetration. But it did not simultaneously have a gradation. So what happens is if there is a crime, a grievous bodily harm is equal to just sexual assault, it could lead to any sentence. You know, it could lead up to the maximum sentence of 7 or 10 years. So there is no gradation that has happened. So what happens is when at this level we see that the Criminal Law Amendment Act did take some feedback from the women's groups, but the framework of understanding was not the same. The women groups were talking about the gradation as well, the simultaneous gradation, but they did widen it, but did not have a simultaneous gradation, which is actually leading to a bigger problem sometimes. The other issue is gender neutrality, which has it's an issue of intense debate among women's groups. The question of gender neutrality is entered through the LGBT groups, basically the lesbian, gay, and bisexual, transgender groups, who have had experiences of sexual assaults, but they're not covered under the present legal system. So the idea was to have, initially it started off with recommendations of having gender neutrality across the board. So the perpetrator or the victim, both could be a man or a woman. But then the women groups were not really happy with the suggestion, because it was a hard fought fight to say that the victim is has to be a woman because they see it in a patriarchal situation. There are certain power relations, and a woman usually, at least in the previous history, there has been no woman who has sexually assaulted a man. But there is also some kind of disagreement between the LGBT groups. Some say they need a separate law that will deal with sexual assaults that they may experience. Some say, no, we still go for gender neutrality. Some say the Section 377, which is which presently criminalizes same-sex relationships, has to be amended to include sexual assaults under LGBT. So there is a diverse view, but for the Justice Verma Committee, at least the women's groups and the LGBT groups realize that we cannot present a diverse view. So they did come with a fragile kind of a consensus to say that the perpetrator has to be a man. But the victim could be either a woman, a man, a person from the LGBT community. But in situations of aggravated sexual violence, like communal violence or gang rape, the perpetrator could also be a woman. So this is nuanced understanding of gender neutrality that has come about.